Once would think, why build a tabernacle? Why build a tent? Why is everything I guess like a shadow of Geta Jesus Christos to come? And that'll help us understand why he is I and that salvation. Basically, it's for our own sake. If the minute that we broke covenant with God Almighty, we should have been dead, we should have been stricken, we should have been annihilated. But since the foundations of the world, Yeta Jesus Christos was there. Everything since the beginning was for him. Everything was made for him, through him, by him. And nothing could ever be without him. Now, this will perfectly explain how it'll give a higher explanation, a higher level of knowledge as to what exactly does that mean. If Geta Jesus Christos had never been there since the beginning, we would all be dead. That is why all Old Testament is trying to is like symbology. It's representing. It's a shadow of things to come. We broke covenant since Adam, since the fall of man. If Geta had not been there since the beginning, we should have been annihilated. But the Almighty chose not to see our transgression because Geta, our salvation, was there since the beginning. And so, the Almighty kind of turned his face around, pretended not to see that, because he knew what was to come. He knew that Geta Jesus Christos would take on sin and do away with sin. So, I mean, that in itself is a beauty. Since the beginning, this was perfectly established. So Adam broke covenant. He should have died. But the great by the grace and the mercy of the Almighty said he knew that Geta Jesus was to come. So he kind of postponed the death of man. If ones can recall, as soon as that happens, if we're not mistaken, there were garments put on Adam and Eve. What were these garments? They put on Christ. Put this on. I mean, the Almighty probably was like, "Put this on. Do not let me see you, 'cause you'll die. I mean, you'll be smitten in without any warning. Just put this on. Put Christ, and that'll kind of remind me of things to come." And prevent me from pouring out all my wrath upon you because you have transgressed. And so that is why it is so important to know that Geta Jesus was there since the beginning. Now, that is one of our coverings. That is the atonement, in a sense, is a tripart work. And so there are three aspects of this. Now, the first, and this is from the outside in. The first covering was the badger skin, the dull and formless, void even, lacking meaning. But then, as you work your way inside, and this is, that in itself has to do with nobody really liked Geta Jesus. He wasn't something pretty, as His Majesty. And this is coming from an earthly perspective, from a sin, false world interpret misinterpretation of truth. The world did not see something that they would consider God. They wanted to see something out of we don't even know what they wanted to see. They wanted to see, I guess, like a woman in a red dress, beautiful, and kind of like that César Borgia, that Caesar's Christ that they, but maybe that's what they were looking for. They were looking for some kind of female beauty with jewelry and gold and whatever it is that they were looking for. But we know the true beauty because we're not about beauty. We are about truth. And so we decided to take on this truth and show ourselves approved. And eventually we get to experience and to witness the majesty on high. I mean, Geta Jesus the Son and Kedamawi Kaile Selassie, the Father, and everything that there is to offer. It's But first, there is that protective cover to avoid having all these hypocrites and peoples that are after some other kind of beauty, keeping them away. But okay, we kind of got a little sidetracked there. So let us continue on with the purpose, and the meaning, the signification of that. Don't expect anyone to like you. Don't expect to portray to rightfully, I guess, reveal truth to the world. I mean, we are going to be hated. If they hated him, the master, our master, Lord and Savior, how much? I mean, they're definitely gonna hate us. But they hated him more. Be sure of that. So every time that we go through things, tribulation, whatever it be, remember, the world hated him. They're gonna hate us. But they hated him more, and so let us recall and bring to memory that he suffered more, that he no one suffered like him, and we'll go into that. But this covering can give us an idea of what to expect and how to go about it. Jesus suffered way more than us. So whatever it is that we have to go through, I mean, just put up with it. The world hated our master. And actually did worse to our master, and so get over it. Whatever it is confronting us, I mean, the life and character, the exemplary life of Yetzai Jesus Christos is enough to do away with that. It is time to put on Christ. So this is one of our reasons for this salvation. Now, secondly, we have the ram skin. Now, this is the strength, and this is I get. We're not sure if we should say blood, but the ram skin was kind of like red. But let us just leave that at, okay, my bad. This is a representation of the substitution. You see, Isaiah chapter 53, it made mention how he took on our iniquities. And so this is a substitution that Getaiasus is offering here, and that's reflected in the ram. It's like, Adam should have died and Eve, but they were put on Christ. They put on Christ. Actually, I mean, the mercy and grace of the Almighty is so exactly that. I mean, uncomprehendable is his grace that he himself said, "Put this on. Put on Christ. If not, I'm a slave right here, right now. You're not worthy." But Getaiasus is, so put him on, and that substituted. That was a substitution for Adam since the beginning. Everything that we have ever done, our earth, our lives, void of meaning and just formless, and walking in sin, all that was done away with a long time ago. As soon as we decide to take on Getaiasus Christos and put him on as worthy armor, tried by fire and all. Withstanding all and beyond that, then we are substituted. It's like being in a football game or something, and you're not doing that well. Then if it's like a moment of, okay, let us just go on forward and say this. The female, excuse me, feminine aspect is the soul. We have to do away with the soul. Get rid of it. All right. I mean, cancel it out. The spirit is the power of the soul. The soul has no power. The soul, our minds, our ego, I mean, let that go. And if we let that go in the ball game, and we cry out to the coach, "Get me out of here! I mean, get me out of here! I can't take this anymore. Just get me out of here." And you're messing up for the team, right? And since before the even game be, since before the game was even scheduled, Getaiasus was, "Put me in, coach, put me in. I'll substitute this individual. I'll make up for what he lacked. I'll score the points that he did not score." Since the beginning, this was played out that way. So this is really, really something else. I mean, it is understood, but do we comprehend it? Do we grasp it? Do we really, really accept it? I mean, we don't know. We can't say. It's not up to us to say, but we do present this evidence because death is a part of our lives, and No one ever brings forth this part of Yetzirah, but one must die, and one must die in the flesh, and in this natural aspect of reality. Kill the soul. You must die. You must suffer. You have to die. Give this up. All right. So basically, what we're saying is there's nothing we could do to help anyone repent and take on and put take on salvation in and through Yetzirah Jesus Christos. And there's nothing we could do. We could pray for once, but it is up to the individual to die and to kill that soul and to let go of himself and admit, I'm not worthy. Take me out of the ball game. I suck. I'm the worst. Get me out of here. But I'll do whatever you want me to do. One is, you see, you're not gonna get to the Almighty by trying to say that you love him and that you're seeking after God. So I mean, it's not. It doesn't work out that way. Even though it will say things that it seems as if that's what we're saying, but it doesn't work out like that. Once one is saved, then you seek. Then you start seeking, but before, it's not really seeking the Almighty. Rather, it's letting go of yourself and admitting that you don't even know what you're seeking. I mean, getting to the point, and this is real death. Getting to the point where it's like, all right, everything that I've seeked for hasn't worked. Just completely let go of yourself and just willingly give yourself for the Almighty and put. Just put your strength and power in him and accept that you are nothing. And the minute that one just cries out with a bitter cry to the Almighty, and it doesn't necessarily have to be like directed to him, but when you're honestly and completely and wholly just done with yourself and have accepted that you are nothing, then the Almighty will then that opens up a space for the Almighty to be to kind of like substitute you with Christ, Getayesus. So it's kind of like it's like when Paul says something to the effect of and forgive I can't really remember all that well, but it says something to the effect of I am dead, but Christ living in me, something like that. But that's what we're trying to say here. It's even if you say, oh, but I want you, Lord, to save me. Oh, I believe in you. That I do away with that innate I. Get rid of that. It's not about you. There are many like you. What makes you so different? If Getaias was the son of the Almighty God, creator of all that is good, if he himself was in our position, what makes you any better than him? It doesn't. You're just like everyone else. Stop it with the I. You're nothing. And so the minute you accept that and you kill and you circumcise yourself from all flesh, from all end flesh, we're saying the soul, from the mind, from whatever it is that you've grown to pretend that you are, let go of it, and that makes space for the substitution. And then it's like tagging Getayesus, and Yesus is jumping up and down. The spirit is doing, I mean, it wanted to be in since the beginning, but Getayesus has been, patiently just on the sidelines waiting for all this to happen for the time, and that time is now, and let us go on forward. There's much more. Let us just bring this forth, all right, because it is necessary. Hebrews chapter 9. Let us go to Hebrews chapter 9. This is, I mean, we had kind of like an idea of what order to go through, but we don't that that is a perfect explanation of what we are to avoid. I mean, let go of the soul. This is jaw order. And so Hebrews chapter 9, and let us direct thine thyself to verse 26, and it reads, For then must he often have suffered since the foundation of the world, but now once in the end of the world hath he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. And as it is appointed to men once to die, but after this the judgment. So Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many, and to them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin to salvation. Getaiesus, 2,000 years ago took on sin. He was our badger skin. That's the first covering. He was our ram skin. That's the second covering. Now the ram skin is the substitution, and the goat skin is exactly this. Him taking on sin, taking on that nature of sin, and doing away with our sin. And so that would be represented in the goat skin. And so what we were trying to say, excuse me, we got kind of carried away there. So that was 2,000 years ago. Yetzayesu's taking on sin and overcoming it. But for those that look for him, he shall come to us the second time. It reads here, and to them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin to salvation. Now this isn't to make any the Father or the Son less. One is the other. I mean, the whole one in the other. And we'll go into more explanation shortly. But the salvation came with his imperial majesty, Kedamawi Kaile Selassie, because this was the second time that he appeared to those that look for him. And he came perfect, because Getayesus had already put away sin. And so it is his majesty that brought salvation and directed us to him, to the Son. You know, so it all plays out perfectly. And I mean, just many are probably thinking, but what about the people before us and stuff like that? Look, there are two kinds of knowledges. There is perfect knowledge and there is partial knowledge. We know partiality. The Almighty knows perfection. So don't get into the whole, don't complex your life by dealing with something that is beyond your comprehension, even ours. The Almighty knows what is up with everyone. He knows perfect knowledge. He knows what to do in what situations, how, when, why, and he does whatever he cares to do. So I mean, so don't worry about that. But the second coming was salvation to us all. You know, this was a, excuse me. We were trying to make the point that, I mean, just look at history and look at the past 2,000 years. Not much salvation has taken place, right? And it may appear as even to this very day, but let us not get overwhelmed by that. Let us just know that salvation is here, it's now. And technically it's been always, you know, since Adam. We've kind of discussed a little on that. So, you know, for all these 2,000 years, you know, we could say that the world has pretty much been up to no good. And so, in a sense, that could give one's better understanding as to how to explain salvation being now with His Imperial Majesty, with God the Father, Kedamawi Kaile Selassie. So let us expound a little further in the whole what we meant by ignorance and partiality. Don't get caught up in how, like, for instance, if there's a person that appears to have done a lot of wrong before, don't get caught up on that. Don't think why he got saved and why not, or why you forgive him or why not. I mean, just don't get caught up in that, because the Almighty might decide to forgive a certain individual and you're still, you know, holding a grudge against another person, and turns out that because of your knowledge of what's going on, you are going to pay the price and suffer the consequences. And this other person, even though he was doing a lot of wrong deeds, you know, ended up being saved, and you end up, you know, suffering. I mean, just we don't have time to be looking at anyone else's lives, you know. Just that is kind of like some advice, you know. Stay away from other people's lives. We can only, you know, be interested in perfecting our lives, because we don't know what kind of situations people are in. The Almighty is the only that possesses, that has perfect knowledge, and so He knows why He does what He does. We have to do away with the whole good and bad. All is for the ultimate purpose of the Almighty. You know, that serpent in the garden doesn't seem all that bad for I and I now. That we, you know, that in fact, we raised that serpent up on that mount on high Because he is worthy. Without that serpent, we wouldn't be here. I mean, that serpent was for the ultimate purpose of the Almighty. It served for us to learn a lesson by experience. You know, we're drawn out of water, and we are molded and shaped to what Jah, if we let ourselves be shaped, right? The Almighty kind of like is working on us and molding us and shaping us to be what He wants us to be. And if we let ourselves be and be flexible, then we'll turn out to be a perfect cross, you know, beauty and different than all the other crosses, you know, unique in some way, yet still the same. And it all has to do with our experiences. That's what shapes us. So do away with the good and evil. You know, all is potentially good. All is good. Coming that being that was created by a good creator, how could anything be bad? Rather, we should take on the approach of, for instance, there is a river in our city, and it's the most contaminated river in the world. And I guess an acquaintance kind of he's starting to catch on to the whole illumination, but not in Ras Tefri. We pray that he does, because he could be of help. But he called Die and Die up, and he's like, let's do something about fixing that river. And the first thing I thought was that river that is the most polluted river in all of North America, and it's the New River, and it's not even a natural river. It was a mistake, an error that these corporations committed when trying to manipulate nature. But I mean, forget that. Who cares? What we're trying to say is that we saw it as that river was placed there for the glory, for the you know, to for the glorification of our God and Father, Kedamawi Kaili Shalasi. That river is like Geta Yesus oftentimes said, when they asked him, who sinned? This man has been blind since birth. Who sinned? Did he sin or did his mother sin? And Quetzalcoatl responds, neither. This man was born this way for the glorification of my father, or something like that. I mean, forgive we don't we're not I mean directly quoting, but we're just trying to get the idea across how some things are for the glory of the Almighty. And if we look at life that way, and because we have uttered these words, then it shall come to pass that river shall be taken care of, and it will be for the glorification of the Almighty. You see, and we shouldn't have said that, to be completely honest. But you know, it's not such a bad idea. That river is indeed very, 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 very harmful. And what better present, what better work than to glorify the Almighty through something that many people would just accept that as evil or wrong, or someone messed up here. No, someone did not correct it. And the mistakes are here to be corrected. And in correcting these mistakes, we glorify our mighty Father, Kedamawi Kaili Shalasi. And so, you know, we kind of we should we don't know what we got ourselves into, but be it for the sake of one learning from another, then so be it. But yeah, you know, I guess now it's out there. If ones want to somehow inform I and I how to go about it, there's a river, and it's the most contaminated river in all of North America, and there's something we got to do about it. And you know, let it be for the glory of the Almighty. Let Ras Tefri shine bright. So let us continue. Oh boy. Now, yeah. Let us go on forth. Now, when Getaesus yelled, my God, he didn't he said, my strength, my power, you know, my power, my power. Why hast thou forsaken me? This was not what people make it out to be. It was, you see, in the crucifixion, neither the body nor the spirit was crucified. The body, that is why after Getzal was like, touch me, you know, like put your hand you know, on my side. It's like, it's me, I'm whole, I'm a man. See, the body, which is the ram, It well, that in itself should explain it. The ram is the substitution. He was the body was not crucified. The body did not die. The flesh did not die in a sense. And then the spirit did not die. But then again, they were never separated from him. What happened was the soul taking on sin, that yell of Getsayesus was the repulsion of his soul, I mean of his spirit and body separating itself from the soul. Now, when Getsayesus was on the cross, and this seems to puzzle a lot of people, and indeed it did us too. And we've been thinking on this for like about a week and a half now, maybe two, and we finally kind of found a way to put it together. You see, when Getsayesus yelled, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" It wasn't that God the Father and the Spirit were not there. It wasn't anything other than the soul being killed in truth, you know? And so the soul taking on sin, it made for it resulted in the spirit and the flesh and the body separating itself from the soul. And because the spirit is the power of the soul yelled out, "Why, power, power, my power, why hast thou forsaken me? Why hast thou left me? You know, why hath the soul died, basically." And Jesus Christos never died as far as the flesh and as far as the spirit. It was the soul. You know, and ones might think that this is kind of like controversial or whatever, but I'm willing to change if ones kind of present a better understanding and present the necessary evidence to prove that what I am in fact saying is wrong. You see, Getsayesus was not afraid of dying. He knew that he was gonna overcome, but he despised sin. He did not want to take on the nature of sin, that filth, but he had to. That's what he was worried about. It wasn't about him dying. He knew what was going on. But let us go deeper into this. Now, many would think, okay, before we go off to the next point, there's if you have to read all of the times that he said this, and so read all of the crucifixion portions within the scriptures. Read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Read them all, and they'll all together they will all make sense. In one of the gospels, it reads, and Getsayesus commended his spirit to the Father. I go to the Father. You know, it wasn't. So keep that in mind. I mean, just to get a better vision, a better sight of the situation. I mean, and we just put that out there because we're kind of leaning towards going to forward to the times of Abraham, and this is how we could kind of explain. So if the soul was being crucified and the soul died, and it kind of there's a repulsion of the body and the spirit of Getsayesus from the soul taking on sin, then where is the soul and the spirit? Well, this is what we say. And time, we don't accept time to be anything other than patterns. We in fact speak of an eternal God and an everlasting, and that is in all truth and all sincerity what is. And many would disagree with this idea, but we care not. If we go forward to the times of Abraham, and if we read verse 11, no, my bad, let's begin from verse 10, and it reads, "And Abraham stretched forth his arms and took the knife to slay his son. And the angel of the Lord called to him out of heaven," out of heaven. The angel of the Lord is calling to Abraham, right? And he said, "Abraham, Abraham." And he said, "Here am I." You see, so while the soul of Getsayesus was taking on sin and dying, and that created like a repulsion effect, and the spirit and the body took off, where were the spirit of Getsayesus and the body of Getsayesus Christos? We dare to make mention that at that exact same time, the angel of the Lord appeared to Abraham and said, "Abraham, Abraham, you know, don't, you know, okay, let's read that again, because, and he said, here I am, and this is what the angel of the Lord said once he yelled from heaven, Abraham, Abraham, from a higher perspective, from a higher realm, from an eternal, everlasting reality. And he said, lay not thy hand upon the lad, neither do thou anything to him, for now I know that thou fearest God, seeing that thou hast not withheld thy fear, thou fearest, thy son from thine only son. Excuse, For now I know that thou fearest God, seeing that thou hast not withheld thy son, thine only son, from me. And Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him a ram caught in a thicket by the horns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered him up. So basically, just think about that. And caught up by the horns, a ram, a so-called strength, caught up at the substitution, the soul being caught up in the horns, in the powers, in the administrations, in the governments of this world, of this of a ticket, right? Of this death sin, of this fake false world system. You see, sin doing away with sin, and the spirit and the flesh overcoming. I mean, we know that we're not doing the best job of explaining this, but it really is that, you know, it's being born again is necessary, and yes, we must die, we must take on the death of ourselves and put on Christ and have Christ living in I and I. So let us go forth. Okay, so now another little detail that is necessary to make mention. The body and the soul, they did take on corruption. The goat, which was represented by the goat skin. Oh, and let us just say that the goat skin is his humanity, and the goats were black, dark brown, because black, it says brown, but it's kind of like either black or dark brown or something similar, and that in itself, it's not really. It is necessary because this is a clear indication of the true humanity of His Imperial Majesty and His Son, Getsayesus Christos. But this could be referenced in the book of Genesis, in the situation with Jacob and Laban. And let us find that really quick so that... This is chapter 30, and verse 33 would probably be the one that ones would be looking for, where Jacob... takes on the speckled, the spotted, and the brown. But brown means dark brown or black. And he says that my righteousness in time will, you know, he says something like it will turn out to be that all these speckled, spotted, brown, will be counted stolen with me. And you know, do the math. I mean, just go into that, and the rest would be. I mean. My bad. Those that are brown and colored and spotted will be counted stolen with me. Will be basically those that are not, and so those that are not are actually, and that has to do with his thigh and that whole cut, his side. They're gonna be put aside, and stuff like that. But we didn't really want to go into that. We just want to put that forth. Now his true humanity is that goat covering. So basically we've described three different coverings that is basically our at-one-ment, our atonement, our salvation, and why and how it is that these things come to be. Now the whole body, the body and the soul took on sin, but it doesn't mean that the body did not die because of what we said previously. What is actually happening here is that the first coming of Getsayesus the Son did not his body also took on sin, so on corruption more correctly. Because it's not that difficult, you see. Yes, he took on corruption, not necessarily on sin, because he was sinless. But having not known sin, knew sin. So he had not sinned, but he had sinned. So that is corruption, basically. That is a confession, which is the confession has to do with the sacrifice. And I mean, let's not go into all the details, but some of these are necessary to go look up. So we would recommend, I guess, as far as the whole sacrifice, one should look at Leviticus chapter 9 and do some reading on that. Hebrews chapter 9, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, that was a part of last week's reading. Exodus chapter 26, it'll give some insight. Isaiah chapter 53. I mean, we're just trying to put some information out there, and hopefully ones will do diligence and seek them out for themselves. Now, so he took on sin, and that was his fear. Not his fear, but that was like, Abba, do I have to do this? If there's any other way, but nonetheless, let it be your way. You see how that's killing the soul? It's not saying I want this, I want that, or I'm repenting, I repent, I'm never gonna do that again. Who cares? It's the fact that Quetzalcoatl sacrificed himself and said, whatever you want to do with me, you know, I don't like this as much as any other, but it's all on you, you know, do whatever thou wilt with I, whatever you say, I'll do whatever you know, whatever, I'll do your will, because that is denying oneself and picking up his cross. And that whole cross that we spoke earlier, if one's watched that video, Cross Art Form of Ethiopia or something like that, it's titled. If you listen closely to how the narrator is describing the making of the cross, that's exactly like how we are being shaped and formed, and how we are presented with an option, with a covenant. It's up to us to put meaning and content into it. If we let ourselves and we value that covenant, then we shall become like beautiful crosses molded by the Most High himself.